So that stuff is like, man, I got to be on tour this time. I got to do this. I got to do this appearance. I got to be at the Thanksgiving Day parade. I got to, you know what I mean? And all that pressure to be the perfect artist or this or that is just weighing down.
And the pressure in hip hop.
Here that if you have an album coming out, other people may be giving you a cold shoulder, but we'll listen to your stuff, we'll feature on your projects. So hit us up, man. We love you guys. Let's get some features done. Let's work, man. Let's go.
All right, back in the field with the Track Stars, Ryan Wright, Sean Tanner, DJ Jeremiah. What's good?
All right, this segment is sponsored by the RWMS Group. That's Right Way Management. Shout out to them. They are actually putting together the first Christian hip-hop / gospel cruise. As of yesterday, they've asked Track Stars to be a part of that panel. I've already set up my deposit to go, so I'm excited. I'm actually using this as an opportunity for me and my wife to celebrate our 7-year anniversary.
Smart.
Yes, isn't it? Yes.
Smart. Until she gets there, like, this is what we're about to do.
Yep, Jeremiah's going to have all three of my kids. I'm excited about that. So, just kidding. He looked up like, what? But, yeah, so definitely this is going to be a great opportunity for us to showcase our talent. And it's really just build, like Sean said, as the body on a cruise where we have non-believers that will possibly be there, as well as people from other countries all around. This cruise cruises to the Bahamas on January 6th through the 10th, leaves out of Fort Lauderdale. If you're thinking about going, hit me up on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, and I'll give you more details. But you can go to rwmsgroup.com. And you'll find all the information there.
I'm going to be honest. We had a lot of options for topics this week. I mean, there was a ton of stuff that happened. If we were a daily show, we'd be straight. we had Nicki versus Cardi MMA match. We had we had M versus MGK. We had M versus Joe Button. We had M versus
Joe Button versus everybody.
NF. So we also had Jeremy Owens. I'm taking Ryan's word for
Jeffrey.
It.
Jeffrey.
With the job shaming. And but this actually shocked me when I saw it. Mac Miller died. And the last one we had was X. When I saw that, I was like, whoa, you just realized somebody's you could feel their life getting cut short, you know? And I felt that with Mac. Mac is obviously not a Christian hip hop artist, but still part of the hip hop community. He always had talent. Everybody always knew his talent. Was he independent? I never quite got a handle on what
his label was. He was signed to Rostrum Records. Okay. They were like independent label.
So he always felt like he was like always kind of bubbly under the scenes.
Rostrum had a situation with a label though.
Oh, they did?
I think they did.
You never know. You did.
Yeah, you never know. Yeah, it's all the same though.
Like a freshman at the same time as Kendrick. Like he was on the same freshman
Mac,
cover.
Mac has always gotten a lot. I've never heard anybody say Mac was whack. Yeah. Never.
Yeah, he
but he never like rose to like. So when I saw it, I was like, whoa.
But he did date Ariana Grande.
He
so
did.
What
what was crazy about that is a lot, when I first saw it, a lot of the news outlets were saying Ariana Grande's ex boyfriend dies.
Yeah.
Like, yo, he's his own dude. Like, maybe they didn't know.
They like blaming her. They're in their comments saying, like, you killed him.
It's been crazy. But what it really highlights, and kind of, this was different for X, but this is a little different for Mac. There was another rapper earlier this year that had an overdose as well. But addiction, mental health, it's been a topic this year. It's been it came up a lot on Everyday Struggle when Joe Button was there. Mm-hmm. It comes up a lot with some of these newer rappers are dealing with a lot of mental health issues. I don't know if it was mental health, but definitely addiction. There's a lot of drugs floating around the hip hop industry. What do you feel about his death? How do you feel about Mac and that whole situation?
Go ahead, man.
Let me start it off.
Yeah.
There you go.
Man, I just think, man, as you're rising, bro, you just gotta like, as you're growing up, you know, you gotta keep like, you gotta keep your mind straight. So it's so very important that you have the right people around you. You have people who will tell you no, because once you're on top, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're on top. So if you know you're gonna guarantee be on top, you gotta be on top the right way. So you really gotta take care of your mind. You gotta take care. You gotta be fresh, man. You gotta be inspirational to people and just see the bigger picture, because you know what I'm saying, you only get one life. So
yeah, I don't know, man. Like, do you think any? I know Lecrae put up a post basically saying he struggled with that as well. Do you think there are a lot of Christian hip hop artists dealing with drugs that we're just not, we're ignoring it because we assume inherently that Christians are okay. But I feel like this may be a wake up call for our industry too, is to make sure everybody is straight. Is anybody struggling with drugs specifically?
I think another thing too is what we've seen is that the thing about Mac Miller, people didn't know, is because he was so comical, he was so funny, he was so lighthearted. So it was like people being lighthearted and like not thinking like, oh, he good, you know what I mean? So I think that was one of those things where drugs is like that numbing. And then here's another thing too, is like when you once were maybe like that, like your stock was rising in hip hop, or you was at a place where you were selling good or whatever. And if that's not the same as once was, and then you lose your girlfriend and she remarried, and you're just feeling all these stuff, and you're like, I just don't know. I just need to medicate myself to feel better. Yeah. And sometimes when you just do too much, it just takes over. And I think people don't know how to cope with life, especially entertainers. I don't think entertainers know how to cope with life. So I think they constantly fill themselves up with drugs or other stuff, especially when that applause start to dim. You know what I mean?
Now, I don't know how y'all been feeling. I don't usually go searching on social media. Honestly, my social media experience is really just managing Trackstarz. I don't do no social media, honestly, for myself, unless it's related to ministry. So I actually started looking just through the general... We have so many people that we follow and follow back and all that kind of stuff that the actual feed is just trash. You know what I mean? Like, so I don't even look at it. But I spent some time this morning looking through it. I woke up at like 5 o'clock and I was just like, man, the world, I just felt dark.
Yeah.
The world felt dark. You know, I see Cardi and Nicki fighting. I see 50 and Mayweather going at each other. I see Joe Button and M going at each other. And then just beyond the celebrity stuff, I'm seeing politics is just trash right now. I see people doing crazy stuff on the internet to get attention. There's an image I saw that I still can't get out of my head. It's gross. But I'm seeing just all kinds of just terrible stuff, and it just felt dark. And I just wonder, how is everybody living with that darkness on a daily basis? I don't look at it. But when I looked at it for 10 minutes, I was like, my heart just felt dark. And I just, that has to be having an effect on these people, man. They're in the midst of darkness constantly. I don't know how anybody is handling feeling that weight of sin and darkness constantly every single day. And I just recommend, if you're feeling like you have so much of a burden that you need to take drugs, you may need to unplug for a second. Because I bet keeping up with what's happening on Real Housewives, and keeping up with what's happening in politics, and keeping up with what's happening with these celebrities, is probably making your spirit sick. Like, you probably feel sick and don't even realize it. And just the 10 minutes of watching it, I'm like, dude, I feel sick. Still, like right now, I still feel the weight of all that crap I saw, looking at people like Academics Page, and looking at World Star, and looking at The Shade Room, and looking at all these. It just feels like everything feels heavy after I watch that stuff. And I'm like, if people are dealing with this all the time, please try and pull away from it, because it's not, your life should not be as dark as what's happening in the world right now. It shouldn't feel that dark all the time.
Yeah, and if you don't have Christ to decipher in that stuff, then it's going to take you away. It will take you away, and it'll take you from a place that you were like, man, I once was here, and then now all of a sudden I'm looking around, I'm like...
Yeah, you won't even notice it. You won't even notice the slide.
And you're numb to stuff.
And I'm this is a big debate. I'm not saying that looking at those things are sinful, because, I mean, honestly, when I'm looking through some of these pages, I'm seeing a lot of likes that I know of people. You know, they'll put their little name like so-and-so like this. Yeah. So I'm like, oh, snap. Yeah. Okay, people know about this stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying when that stuff gets in you too much, you may not realize what it's doing, but it's having an effect on you. And I got my shows that I watch, and I got my things and podcasts I listen to that ain't 100% up and up. But when you feel your heart getting into that, like, it's just like that.
Yeah.
If you seen the new Eminem video, The Fall?
No.
It's like a ghost, dark black ghost thing chasing him. That personifies a real thing that could happen to your heart, like the clouds with darkness.
Yeah.
And if you start feeling any of that, man, unplug, get out, turn that off, because it could really overtake you. It really can.
So what do we say to the person that's saying, like, you know, these drugs, man, they just, I, I'm, this is my thing, you know what I mean? Like, when I want to, I don't feel peace nowhere else, you know? I don't feel joy or anything, but this brings me a peace. This brings me a release. What do we say to that person?
It's not true. The release, the only real release is a relationship with God. Like, I've never felt it so much as today. Like, and it's not just just watching stuff on the internet. It's also mm-hmm. the pressure of this industry. Yeah. I mean, honestly, I felt down after this morning. I'm like, man, is any of this helping anybody? Like, we're just sitting there, like, doing this stuff every week, and I'm like, y'all are still acting like this? None of this is helping? And it just felt, it made me feel depressed. Like, I felt like, man, like, God, how am I supposed to do what you asked me to do? How is working with Trackstarz and doing music and making these spoken word pieces and spending all night working on graphics and websites and mixing and mastering, how is this helping when these people are still not, I'm not seeing the effect at all? And it just made me feel down. And I can't, not saying that that was Mac's point of view on this, but if you're in the industry and you're constantly grinding, you're constantly trying to make an impact, and you're constantly trying to make it and be known and have money, it could be depressing. This industry is terrible. Terrible industry.
You got to think about it this another way, too. The industry makes you sacrifice stuff that the normal person would, like, value. Like, think about it. Like, the times when you have Christmas, Thanksgiving, or whatever with your family, that person that's an entertainer at times is working on Christmas or working on Thanksgiving or got something around that holiday where they can't even go to see their families. So that stuff is like, man, I got to be on tour this time. I got to do this. I got to do this appearance. I got to be at the Thanksgiving Day parade. I got to, you know what I mean? And all that pressure to be the perfect artist or this or that is just weighing down
and
on people.
The pressure in hip hop is even worse because there's a pressure to be tough and to be, you know, exciting and to be provocative. Like, I'm looking at Tekashi this morning and I'm like, it would stress me out to be that kid. I know he feels like he's doing well, and he is. He's doing really well. He's getting a lot of attention. But, like, just to constantly be in beast and constantly have to be on and that, like, that's stressful. That's really stressful. And I don't think they realize how stressful that is to be. I'm looking at, what's my man? Lecrae and Ty Dolla. I think he just got arrested.
Yeah, for drugs.
And it's like the life you have to be around to be in this industry is stressful.
Yeah.
It's stressful. There's drugs, gangs, all kinds of women. Like, it's just not a conducive life to peace.
Yeah.
And just pray for these people because everybody assumes, oh, they rich, so they good.
Yeah.
A lot of these people ain't even rich.
Yeah.
They just look
famous,
rich.
Yeah.
Just in a lot of debt.
They in debt or they still owe their label money back. So these people, you think they're good, but they're not good. They're not good. I felt really bad for the whole industry today. Really bad.
Yeah. Go ahead, bro.
I'm like torn because, like, I'm 28, so I'm older, but yet I feel like I'm stuck in this. Because it's like a wave of, like, these kids who are doing drugs.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's the cool thing to do. Before, they say they went from the drug dealers to, like, the drug users now. So before, it was cool to be a drug dealer. Now it's cool to be a drug user.
Yeah.
And it's all these rappers talking about the drugs they doing, and these kids are pumping it into them. So, like, I feel like I have to watch in a way because, like, I want to know what the kids are into. So it's like, I feel this weird balance of, like, I don't want to let this stuff get in my spirit, but also I want to know what's going on. So, like, I look at Tekashi's band, Little Skies and Lil Xan, all these people. Like, I want to know who they are so I can talk to the younger kids to know what they looking at. And it's like, all these people they looking up to, if you, like, watch them closely, they're depressed. So they'll be putting out posts saying they're like, I just want to end my life. I want to kill myself. So, like, these people are, like, self-medicating. That's what it is. It's like,
part of the medication is the fame.
Yeah.
Like, it's like a hit. Every video that drops and you get a bunch of likes, it's a hit.
Yeah.
Every time you're on TV, every time you're mentioned by another rapper as somebody that they like, it's a hit. And I'm afraid for us as Christian hip hop artists and labels and entities, every time you get a lot of views, every time you get a lot of likes, every time you get mentioned, every time your picture shows up somewhere, it's like a hit. When that hit gets taken away, or you need a bigger hit to feel the same, just like drugs, right? Yeah. You can't get the same amount of likes on the next picture. You got to try and get. So it's a drug, and this whole thing is a drug, and I'm afraid people are using. A lot of us are using, and it's scary. It's a scary feeling.
How do, like, as Christians, though, do we, like, get away from that? Because, like, that's something I struggle with. Like, when do I know if I'm doing it for the like or just because, like, I have to do this to move forward in my career and do what God has called me to? So it's kind of like this constant battle in me of, like, is this prideful or is this just a part of my mission?
I would say, I would probably say exception. Like, like, if you're doing something to get those likes and get those exceptions and accepting, like this is your, this is telling you how to live versus
I think what's hard and what he's getting at is, let's just, there's just like math to this, right? In order to become, like, a lot of people feel their vision is to take their art and help a lot of people, right?
Yeah.
To be an artist on a world stage and say something in a way that Jay-Z wouldn't, or say something in a way that Eminem wouldn't, to bring people more to Christ instead of something else, right? Everybody, every artist that's really doing this, they probably feel like God called them to that, right? The math says that the only way for you to do that is to get a lot of likes, a lot of followers, a deal, money, some sort of, you have to get that stuff in order to be on the path towards that, right?
Yeah.
How do you know while you're going down that path? Is this because I want to be a rapper? Is this because I want to be famous? Is this because I want money?
Yeah.
Or is it just the necessary steps to get to what you feel God's vision for your life is? I think people get lost in that. They get lost in that.
I think you just got to trust the process, man. And you got a good point, like, because it's like you got to give to get something, but you got to trust the process, because a lot of people do it different way. But, like, we can watch example like Lecrae. Lecrae, they ain't really give. He just stayed true. And he didn't, like, sell out. Not what I think is sell out. At least he just, like, stayed true and always said Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And then the world came to him. So I think as for us, once we stay true, we just got to stay true. And we cannot look outside for entertainment or for, like, trying to say, oh, this is what I got to do. This is what I got to do. I'm going to stay true and believe in God and know everything going to come out.
Yeah.
I think what scares me about all this, and Sean and I, we talk about this all the time. We talked about it this week, as a matter of fact, is that everybody's trying to get to that next million, right? Yeah. Why wasn't 15 million enough to where you're like, man, hopefully next year I'll make 16 million. You know what I mean? And so you just keep climbing and climbing. And when you look back, nothing's enough, right? And then you start to feel like you're not successful. We were talking about this show and how it started 11 years ago in a basement of my college, right? And we were just sitting there, and it's like now we're on FM radio stations, AM radio stations, satellite TV shows, and we were signed to a large deal that took us into, you know, a bunch of households. And it's just like, wow, but we still can't give up our jobs yet. You know, I mean, we still can't quit and do this full time because we want to, and this is what we feel like we're called to do. We still have to be smart about it. And I think that's what the industry, it's going to take for Christian hip hop artists to make it in this industry, is decide that no matter what comes, if I have to work a 9-to-5, I'm doing this for Jesus, right? And that's not going to ever change. And so I was just saying to Sean the other day, I was like, I feel like whatever level we get to is always going to be about Jesus. I don't care what people say or how it looks, or if they feel like, you know, these guys are on a red carpet or these guys are getting ushered in through back doors. Like, that was the biggest thing that bothered me when I saw people getting ushered through back doors. And I was just like, whoa, well, why can't we say hello? You know what I mean? Like, what are we going to do to you? You know what I mean? You're a Christian hip hop artist. Why are you going to the back door? So to me, that was like one of the things I was just like, I hope I never become that.
Right now.
I think here's I think the fear that everybody has. What do you think God would be more mad at? If you don't get to that whatever so-called vision you had for yourself, or if you do get there and you compromised? And I think people have that struggle of, are you willing to not get to that vision? I have a vision that I feel like God gave me for why we're even doing all this Trackstar stuff, right? And Ryan felt the same way, and Jeremiah felt the same. We had like visions that matched up, and it's like, okay, there's the vision that we believe God wants us to get to this.
Mm-hmm.
What would be worse if we fail to get to the vision? Would God be mad that we didn't do what was necessary to get there? Or would it be worse if we got there and we bastardized it? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, what's worse? And I think we really have to wrestle with that. I think God would be more mad if we got there and messed and we lost our heart than not getting there at all. And I don't think people are cool with that.
Yeah.
Are you really okay with not getting that vision you saw? You know, it's like a Hebrews thing, right? You may not get to see it. You may be just the kickoff to get closer to it, but you may not be the one that gets to see it.
I think the thing I know for me is, using that same analogy, is sometimes that you want it to be somewhere because you like, yo, the years, the hard work, the dedication, the times when you like could have been with your family, but you like, yo, this is the mission that God put in our hearts. So it's like, yeah, it gets hard. And like, I'm not saying to blow up. I'm just saying, Father, like, okay, reward the effort that we put in. But at the same time, I think about Moses. Like, Moses didn't see the promised land, but he had this walk with those people to it until he got there. I mean, till he gave the reins to somebody else. Yeah. So, I mean, at the same time, it's just like, that's the hard thing as, not even as an artist, but just as somebody that's a part of something. It's like, when you get to that place and you know God wants to take you to another level, or he possibly can, but you still want that. You still want to go to that another level, because it's like you said, like I think Ryan just said, like, you want to get off your job. You want to do something that you're passionate about and love. You know what I mean? But I think at the same time, you gotta understand that that can't be your God. That's another thing too. Mm. Like idolizing being full time or idolizing doing something for God, because that could be an idol too. You know what I mean?
So there's nothing we could do to help Mac Miller now. But what I'm worried about is the Mac Millers to come. Like, is there anybody in our community, even outside of the Christian hip hop community, that's struggling with this? What can we do to help? Because that's like a silent struggle for a lot of people.
Yeah.
You do that in your room by yourself. You know what I mean? Like, a lot of people don't know that you may be struggling with that. And I just want to make sure that people know they have somewhere to go. You know what I mean? There's somebody you can talk to. So, I don't know.
That's why, like, I know a lot of people, that's why I like Lecrae, because at the end of the day, we need more rappers who could be in these people's lives, because the rappers that are there around, the people in their circles, are not going to tell them, hey, to put that down. Right. So, like, if you have somebody that, people who are rooted enough in Christ who could be in this world and be influenced to these rappers, like, I don't think there's no other way, really, than people to infiltrate their world, because they're not going to come to us. We got to go to them. And even the Christians that are in this world who are struggling with that, they feel like, well, I'm a CHH artist. I can't put that in my music that I'm struggling with that, because you're going to lose the youth groups. You're going to lose all these things. So it's like this need for perfection for Christians. And it's also like people don't want to get their hands dirty. They don't want to go out to these places. So it's like, that's why, like, I respect Lecrae. You see him with Meek Mill and stuff, like, people bash him, but he's like, you don't know if they had a deep conversation. Yeah. You know what I mean? Where he led him to the Lord and all these other type of things. So I'm like, I guess it's like a weird balance of, like, we need somebody who's willing to go on the front lines.
Same thing with CeCe Winans and Whitney Houston. I saw a documentary about Whitney Houston. Going towards her last days, she was trying to get clean. So CeCe Winans was been her friend for years, like talking to her, trying to get things right with her. And she was there for her in her last, going towards her last days of on earth. And, well, I mean, of course, she ended up dying in a drug situation too. But at the same time, she was just there. And sometimes people just need you to be there for them. You know what I mean? And to any CHH artist that is struggling with this, I think you just have to have the conversation and really be open to somebody that you genuinely trust. Mm. You know what I mean? And then also, sometimes God may have to pull you away from the scene so that you could get right. So you could be like, yo, I need to change my life. I need my life to really be like God clinging to you more than substance.
So it's the same thing for missionaries. When a church sends missionaries, you pray for the people they're going to reach, but you also pray for the missionary that they don't get you know, sucked into the culture. They don't fall to
ambassadors,
the same. So I think that's how we really got to pray for these artists and these in companies like ours that are trying to be missionaries in the industry. I like what Meg Nick just said, and I want to leave on this one. The visions never really look the same in retrospect. The journey is the real vision. I think that's what we really have to remember. We may see this picture of what it's going to look like when it's all over, but what God really has for us is the daily stuff.
Yeah.
That's the real vision. It's actually walking it out, whether it in your mind is successful or not.
Yeah, yeah.
The fact that you did it every day and you committed your life to following God is the point, you know? So hopefully somebody seeing you commit your life to doing this day in and day out is going to influence somebody else to do the same thing, and it's going to influence somebody else to do the same thing, and it's going to influence somebody else. That's the real point, not just if you're a superstar rapper. You know what I'm saying? So
exactly.
I think
really agree with you.
If we all feel that way, I think we'll be good.
Because you could be like, you could be walking by faith, like what you just said. You know what I'm saying? People can be seeing you by leading example, and that's like, to you, that might not be like, oh man, I haven't hit the top yet. But that's so much, you know what I'm saying? Because you're touching souls that could rub off on other people.
Yeah.
And you're inspiring people, and you know what I'm saying? And just because just because you're not at the spotlight, it just don't mean like that's all to life, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that goes to everybody listening. No matter how big or small you think you are, like your influence can stretch through generations. You may influence the person that's going to influence a million people. It doesn't matter who gets the credit for the million people. It's you walk out what you were called to do, however successful it looks to other people. Success is in the kingdom, not on earth, right? So anyway, let's get back into it. You in the field with the track stars, Ryan Wright to Shantan and DJ Jeremiah. Let go.
Hey guys, Miracle here. Thank you so much for watching that episode. Make sure you go below, like it, subscribe, click the bell, and make sure you follow us on all forms of our social media. Also, check out our website and be sure you spread the word. We'll see you next time.
We know not what we doing. Screw that, they know, let them have it, do it. Okay, I'm around it, prove it. Never mind, got a mind that'll wind up with me in a lineup behind bars with these bars. Okay, my time's up.
Team Freedom,
yeah,
we not through yet.
All right.
Trackstarz Music presents.
Turn my volume up, turn me off.